Hey, so glad to get back together with everybody. We're looking at our second of three nights. We're looking at the nativity with a couple of different lenses. One is through some video clips that I showed you, and we're going to dive into something a little more booky tonight. We're going to kind of play a double barrel with this one, what we've been doing to set the tone, and then look at some book stuff, because you know, that's where all the fun really comes from, the book stuff, right? And I got a test, I got a quiz, because if you have book stuff, you have to take a quiz, don't you? That's not the way it works. Cindy says no, I don't know that. Well, we'll see. Little quiz. So now when we were together last time, I found a lovely little video. And remember what we're doing, looking at these videos, okay? So I got three for us tonight. One of them will be very familiar to everybody who's been in the Chosen program that we've been doing. And that is, we're looking at these from two different perspectives. One, we're looking at these for what is included, or one, what is not included. So that points to what we expect to see. So I watch a video, I see this video, and I'm like, wait a minute, why didn't they do that? Or I watch the video and I say, what was that? That there's something added or something missing from the video that is important to me when I am thinking of and experiencing the nativity, approaching the nativity of the Lord. So I asked you before when we were talking, what key component for you as an individual is important in the nativity story? And you know, we can go all kinds of places there. So I want to whittle it down, because I'm talking specifically, like you might say, well, what's really important to me is salvation. You know, that God became incarnate. That's the most important thing. I completely agree. But I'm talking about when you think of the nativity story, about what's happening to Mary and Joseph and what's going on around the events of the night. What event, what thing happening in that story is the place where you go, your heart, your mind? When you think of the nativity story, of course, you think about the baby Jesus there in the manger. There he is. He's on the front of the cart in the window and all that other stuff. But you know what? When I stop and really think about it, my mind seems to fall on the shepherds. I really look forward to the shepherd part. So that's the type of thing I'm thinking about. Where is your mind going? It may be that you just really focus on the cradle and that's just it. But getting closer to being a little more detailed in how we think about the nativity and where your mind goes is, believe it or not, pretty important. It's it'll say a lot about how you're approaching the event and how, knowing this, you can now approach it differently. So it becomes new again. So to make that point, I've got a short video for you. This one's just a few minutes long, less than 3 minutes. And after that, we'll see what you saw or what you didn't see, what was included or was not included in it. And we'll go from there. All right, you ready?
This is Joseph. And this is Mary. Mary and Joseph lived in a town called Nazareth. One night, an angel visited Mary and told her that she was going to have a baby, a special baby, who was God's own son.
I am the servant of the Lord. I will do what God wants.
Mary and Joseph were excited, but before the baby was born, they had to travel to their hometown of Bethlehem. It was time for the people to be counted, and everyone's name had to be added to a list. Finally, they got to Bethlehem. It was late and they needed a place to stay. They kept asking, but everywhere was full.
Have you got a room where we can stay? My wife needs to lie down. She's going to have a baby soon.
Well, the only place I have left is the stable with the animals. Come and see.
So Mary and Joseph settled down in the stable, and that night the baby was born. His name was Jesus. They laid him to sleep in a manger. That same night, out on the hillside, shepherds were watching over their sheep, when suddenly a bright light appeared in the sky. It was a whole host of angels singing praises to God.
Don't be afraid. We have come to tell you some wonderful news. A baby has been born, God's own son. He will be the savior of the world. You will find him in a stable in Bethlehem.
A baby who is God's own son? The savior of the world? Come on, let's go and see him.
Three wise men had been following a star, and it led them to the stable where the baby lay. They bowed before him and gave him the presents they had brought. Everyone in the stable that night knew that this baby was very special. Even though Jesus was born in a stable, he would grow up to be the savior of the world.
All right. Pretty cool, huh? All right, what'd you think? What'd you see? What didn't you see?
Well, the angel appeared to Joseph also.
Oh, yeah, not in this one.
I know.
What else? I mean, this is for the children, right? This is a children's program. So they make it very, very simple, as they would. And they reaffirm some very dearly held beliefs about the nativity story. So what, did you see anything that was unexpected in the story? Or did it all look very, pretty much, I mean, as it goes, normal, nothing out of the ordinary?
Didn't we talk about last time that there was something more than the manger? Like, I thought there's some like common belief myth about the manger that's been debunked.
Well, that I love that manger. It's a beautiful manger. It looked just like the kind my mom had on the dining room table for the nativity. There were no wooden manger. There were no wooden barns in Israel. They are something would be the kin of a first century garage built on the back of the house, which would be a stone enclosure, or it would literally have been a hollowed out portion of the hill, a cave, maybe a three-sided cave with a wooden front on it, but definitely a cave-like structure. If it's not, like I say, literally a garage, first century garage, it would be your building, and you would have slapped together some stonework in the back and made another enclosure that the animals would live in. So definitely not a freestanding building out in the middle of the in the middle of the field for the animals. So that's one, sure. Yeah.
Did the wise men actually visit the stable?
No. No. You know, they took the wise men. Wise men started following the star when the star lit. And the star lit when the Christ was born. So all of our stories that point to this would indicate that the star rose and to show that the Christ was going to be born about 2 years before he was born, because that's when they would have started out. It's been a year and a half, 2 years out before he was born. So that isn't right. He was about 2 years old by the time they got to him. He was a child. He wasn't a baby.
They would have been in Egypt too, then.
It's really? just prior to that. Yeah. In fact, that's part of that sequence of events where Herod becomes aware of the child through the visiting of the wise men, right? Because they come and they say, the king. And so he wants to hunt down the king and pay homage. Remember, he says, come back through Jerusalem and tell me where he is so I can go worship him as well. And the angel warns them and they don't go back that way. And the next thing he does is he says, well, I can't find the individual child because they didn't come and tell me. So I'm just going to go murder all the two-year-olds. So he went to Bethlehem and killed all the two-year-olds and younger. So you see, because it's been 2 years. It hasn't been, wasn't going looking for a five-day-old baby. It had been, the wise men, this said, this is how long we've been traveling from when the star came up. All right, what else? Anything else? It's okay. There are some things that we're going to see that you're going to realize as we go. These are not taking away. Remember, we're not taking away anything from the nativity. We're putting something into it. There's some great truth that's unfolding as we draw closer and closer to the biblical account and then match that with our nativity story that we enjoy. And what's going to come out of it is this other blessing. So now I did leave. What was the last nativity we had last week? Did anybody remember? There was something very specific about the nativity story that we saw last time that had to do with Joseph.
Was it the one that was made by the kids?
No. No. This one was the one where in fact, they were in a cave. Remember?
Oh.
Was he there?
He walked into the cave. He wasn't there.
When that's right. He showed up. Yeah, he showed up.
He wasn't. First of all, it was like the Marriott of all caves. It was this huge, beautiful cave. I mean, it was really nice. And then Mary was up on that shelf, that cave shelf thing, and the hole in the ceiling and the star like lit up. So when Joseph came back with like a bucket of water or something and turned the corner, he sees Mary. It's a Christmas card. She's there holding the baby and the light, the moonbeam, the star beam is down on her and she's all angelic. And he's like, so what did we discern from that event? Said that Joseph wasn't there. And so what was the person, what was the makers of this portrayal of the nativity trying to do? What were they trying to say?
Well, if they were trying, if this was intentional, then Joseph is basically a bystander throughout the whole thing, which most, at least modern fathers, never are. And that the sort of the deep connection between Mary, the Virgin Mary, and the Son of God is preserved because there's no other human there yet.
Right. There was the father was there.
Yeah. But sort of the Madonna and child aspect of Jesus's birth story rather than, I think isn't it in the Gospel of Matthew that Joseph gets a bigger role? But in some of the other Gospels, it's all about Mary. You know, it's like you go buy stamps at the post office. There's no Madonna and father and child. It's mother and child. So.
Yes. In fact, you may remember that I mentioned that we're doing in our icon class at church on Sunday. I've presented a lot of icons of the Madonna, the Blessed Mother and child, but no icons of Joseph. There are very few, and intentionally, because the theology of the Orthodox Church and the theology of the Roman Catholic Church, and the Orthodox Church, of course, is the home of the icons, right? The icons in the Roman Catholic tradition are derivative. They learned all they knew from the Orthodox, and the Roman Catholic icons have gone a little afield if you talk to the Orthodox about it. But the theology of the Orthodox and the theology of the Roman Catholic Church is the same pretty much on this. And that is that, as Jenny said it perfectly, Joseph was more of a bystander. He really was commissioned by God to be the earthly caretaker for the Madonna and child, and that was really it. There is only one approved icon, which I'm going to show to the icon class, of the Holy Family, and that approved icon is Mary on one side, touching the baby, and the child in the middle, and Joseph on the other side, looking but not touching. And that's okay because he's a caretaker. He's a little bit apart. The only other thing about that one that was a little odd with this theology in mind is that that theological perspective says that Joseph was probably in his 70s, 60s, 70s, or 80s. And he was the sage elder caretaker, almost more like grandfather figure than a husband of near age, you know, near is within 20 years. So that other one, the Joseph that came down in the Marriott cave, he was a younger guy. But then Mary was a little bit older, wasn't she? She wasn't 14. In none of these is she 14, by the way. You notice that she never really appears to be 14 years old. Some of them do better than that, better than others, but not so much. So to be fair, let's be fair, right? I have another clip for you. This one is, this one's a little bit longer. It's 5 minutes long. And this one, I think, makes up for the last one. All right? So we'll see where this goes.
Gaspar. A star shall come forth. Thank you. is your faith now? Good tidings of great joy, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. You will find a child wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.
Been given the strength I prayed for. Strength from God. And from you.
Okay, big difference, huh? Complete 360 from the other one. So what'd you see in this one?
Never seen Joseph that involved before.
Ah.
So, but it makes sense. It makes sense. She would have needed a little help.
Well,
Bill and I have in the past watched Call the Midwife. I don't know if you guys are familiar with that show, but we're always teasing William, because he runs screaming from the room, doesn't really enjoy the show. So I was thinking that was Bill's boy to have the realities of childbirth right in front of us. That was pretty human story, human side of it.
Yes, very, very. So this would definitely not have been a production that would have been put on by the somebody who was Roman Catholic or Orthodox. Definitely not that movie. Different complete process. So what did you see? So let's stick with Mary and Joseph for a minute. What was evolving? What did you see coming out of that event? Obviously, we missed a little bit of the dialogue at the end because he said, "Are you okay?" And she said, I got the strength that I prayed for from God. And then she added, and from you.
He was emotional afterward.
Yes.
I think they portrayed a love for each other.
Yes.
I'm going to say they seem to be closer as a couple.
Yeah.
Because of the event.
Yep. And I think that's, and I have not watched the whole film, but that's what I got from that last comment that she made. Because I can imagine back in their conversation before this happened, that he may have shared something like, "How do I do this? I'm not needed. You know, God's really taking care of this whole thing. If this is God's baby, you know you're going to have it. It's not like you're in danger." And I can imagine he was saying in some way, "I feel a little superfluous." But so her confirmation of that, you know, "I got my strength from God." and from you was that love moment saying, you are a part, you're my partner. You're the one that God's given me to do this, to be a part of this birth, which he was fully a part of that birth, no doubt about it, call a midwife. And look like what was going forward. He was completely a part of her life from that point on. They were very
part of the family.
Yes.
I mean, the family.
Very tender. Like, we got to see Jesus is a little behind. And he laughed and held a naked baby up. It was great. It was really great. Very, like Janine said, very human, very, very real. Okay, let's jump to the, I think there's a revelatory possibility in what happened. Well, first of all, what else did you see? What was the next thing that we saw that was kind of, there it is again?
I think there was a big emphasis put on the star in this one.
Mm. Yes. Yes. Star has a, so what is the author of this saying about the event based on that?
I'm not sure how I got it, but it seemed to resemble like God's presence, like after Jesus was born, Mary looked up and Joseph looked up.
So we want to know, I think I'm gonna help you this because I'm trying to fold this, and I know I'm sensitive all our time. So in the first one that we saw, or one of the ones that we saw last week, we see that the crafter of the film wants to maintain the ever virgin place of Mary. Mary was the unique Madonna who required no human assistance to have a baby. Baby Jesus came out all washed and clean. I can't even imagine from that film that she contorted her face at all during that birth. It just kind of just happened. You know, she's, I don't know, you know, and she was completely self-sufficient, so that I can imagine the image I'm getting here is that this must be how the rest of her life was. You know, Joseph was there as a caretaker, but if God took care of her so completely at the time of the birth of Christ, then that must have been her life, cared for by God, her husband, that took care of her. And Joseph was there to provide the human side of it. And that was what the crafter of that image wanted to continue to convey. All right, so what's this image trying to convey? We're throwing in the star. So if I'm making this film, Will said the star is a big part of it. It did. So what's the author of this film saying with the star? The star is the sign of cosmic control, cosmic universal. It's a cosmic event, universal control. The star is dominant because God is completely and utterly and absolutely involved in all aspects of this event. God's power, God's providence, God's plan, it's all right there, shining a laser beam of light down onto Bethlehem in the middle of the night. Much gentler, I think, than the other one, by the way. I think this one was a gentler way. Then who saw it? Who saw it first?
Wise men.
There they are again.
Then the shepherds.
Then the shepherds. Now here's the revelatory moment that I want you to hang on to. I'm willing to bet. You have to tell me now. I'm willing to bet that nobody here, this shows you the value of what we're doing here. Nobody here has considered the revelatory image that this movie portrayed in response to the biblical narrative. And it was clearly done by the angel appearing to who?
Singular shepherd, wasn't it?
Shepherd.
Yeah. Jay gets the gold star. The singular shepherd. It wasn't a group of shepherds. It wasn't like eight shepherds hanging out having a beer. You know, it wasn't four shepherds. It was one old shepherd guy. And, you know, in the crutch, he was down there in a little crutchy valley with this angel. Like, all alone right there. And the dude was like climbing up the hill to see where it's going on. And what did he see when he looked over the hill?
Saw the star. Saw the
star shining on, yeah.
And what else? Did you look down from the star? Did you look to the manger and then look down below it? What was going on right there? He was up a little hill. What was going on down in the valley in front of him? You see?
Didn't see that.
All the other individual shepherds were leaving their little clutches and starting to walk across. So what's this? What is this interesting image? Isn't it, at first blush, isn't it kind of a weird omission that this movie is suggesting that God sent a single angel to a single shepherd? We're used to God sending the heavenly host, and there appeared a heavenly host, and they told the shepherds, right? So we all think of your image. Tell me if I'm wrong. Your image forever has been all the shepherds pretty much gathered together in one place.
Yeah.
But this person wanted to portray that the revelation of God was done to each individual shepherd. Every shepherd saw the angel as an individual event in their life. And then they individually left their clutch, left their sheep, and started out and came together as a group at the Nativity in Bethlehem. They didn't start out as a group, which makes perfect sense because different shepherds with different sheep aren't all hanging with their sheep together. They're in different places. They're not together. So this was, an amazing gift here for us that the portrayal or the suggestion is that the revelation that God has, the universal revelation that God has for everyone is very personally just for you. You receive the revelation. And because you receive it and the other person receives the same revelation, doesn't diminish you receiving it. We all get to receive this together, but God gives it to each one of us because God speaks and loves and responds and cares for and attends to each one of us personally. I thought, it was really cool they stuck that in there. This kind of totally new way of understanding the revelatory process of God as this lovingly targeted event to each one of us. So we receive it as a group, but we also receive it as an individual. Yeah. So this was, I think, remember when I did that class years ago and I said, sometimes these, and we watched the secular movies, sometimes the secular movies aren't setting out to give any kind of God reference in their movie. And then you watch it through the eyes of faith, and suddenly you see the image of God and the intention of God and the action of the Spirit all through the story. And sometimes in really profound ways that I absolutely know that the director and the producers of this movie did not intend at all. And 99% of the population don't see it because they're not looking. They're not looking with the eyes of faith. They're not looking for the event to take place, and they don't see it. It's only when we got together and watched, I don't know if you all remember, there was something we watched. It was a Disney film that we watched. And when I said we're watching it, Louise LaFoon, all the Foons were there, and Louise went, oh no. Because she'd seen it like five times with the kids, with the grandkids, and she watched it like, oh, I'm so burned out on this movie. I can't believe it. And I was like, okay, hang in there, Louise, don't just. And when the movie was over and we started to talk about it, Louise just was like, oh my gosh, I never saw that. That's so incredible. This was the best movie I've ever seen. She was right in there because she was able to look at it now, not as, which is, I'm not taking away the movie with the grands, or the movie with the kids, or the movie as a family. She was first and foremost seeing it as, what is God saying? What is God shining through this film, through the imagery, through the story to me, that the author didn't intend, the director didn't intend, and yet look, there it is, as plain as day. So that type of thing. This is the gift of coming to the Nativity again, new, not going into it this year as we all have gone into it for so many years, as we see it and expect it, and we look for that one place where we like to go in our attention, but now seeing and experiencing it differently, new, in a new way. All right, I got one more for you. Like I say, if you're in the chosen group, you're gonna like this one. It's about, let's see, this is gonna be 11. Yeah, it's not that long. Oh, I guess it is. 3 minutes? I don't think it's too long. All right, you ready? One more?
Shall call his name Emmanuel.
Thank you. so beautiful.
We must tell someone.
We must tell everyone.
We must tell everyone.
Everyone. Yes, yes, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We've waited for this for so long. So long.
His arm. His arm.
His arm.
His arm.
Yes, his arm.
Oh, it's okay. What will you name him?
Jesus.
We will name him Jesus. I must go. People must know. People must know.
People must know.
Given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore.
You! I told you not to come back here. So where is it? Have you found a spotless lamb for sacrifice?
Oh. Such a powerful segment. Oh my goodness. All right. So what did you see in this one? Holy smokes.
Well, they seemed surprised when that bunch of people showed up.
In town? Yeah. So the, you know, the backstory here, there's a couple backstories that we don't consider. And this one, this really shot right to the place as soon as you get into Mary. Remember, woman in childbirth and after childbirth was ritually unclean. So the men, any men that would have been with them, and that's why men would not normally have been with the women, because they couldn't go to synagogue, they couldn't go to temple, they couldn't go to the gatherings of the men after that. So they would purposely and pointedly stay away from this event. And in this one, the shepherds, because of what they've been told, that doesn't make any difference anymore. It's done. That whole segmented, broken, you know, this is an unclean thing. So this is another great revelatory moment. What for a people who observed this event and hallowed this event, but hallowed it in a kind of a backwards way, you know, childbirth, that the event of the birth of the Christ child flipped that reality on its head by God coming, becoming incarnate and born of a woman, made the process of childbirth a hallowed, holy event, not like it had been experienced or regarded within the context of the faith up until that time. And that this,
I think you're giving a more theological explanation of the question that was striking me, because this is the second one where the childbirth scene is more graphic and more human, you know, more obviously pain and travail, right, is present in the little clip we saw. A woman having a child is, you know, a painful, a messy, and probably the height of what it means to be human, all in one little instance. So it made me think to how important it's been over the centuries that, you know, Jesus has a virgin birth. So the whole humanity of conception is removed from the story, but certainly not the humanity of everything after conception, right? Everything afterwards, the pregnancy, the discomfort, the travel on the donkey, the desperation of not having a safe and clean lodging, then the actual birth, which we've seen twice now tonight. So it makes me just wonder, you know, why the church has held to that so strongly, because virgin birth, like, isn't it the Roman Catholic Church that made it a doctrine that Mary is a virgin birth as well?
No, she was virgin her whole life.
No,
but she also is of a virgin birth.
No. Mary's immaculately conceived.
Ah.
Right. So what that means is that that original sin was removed from the birth of Mary. So Mary wasn't stained with original. She still had sin, but she did not have which is not stained with original sin. She was immaculate.
That's what made me think about it, because I remembered from the scripture of original sin and the getting kicked out of the garden, was one of the big consequences, was that childbirth would now be travail and pain.
Right.
So here we are witnessing that, where, you know, Jesus is, like Bill is saying, almost being born through the sin brought by Adam, which is right, must be part of his humanity.
Yep.
Yeah, that's pretty wild. And yet preserve the conception is before. Yeah, that's pretty wild. Well, I don't actually have a point to make, so I'll be quiet now.
Oh no, that's the point. I mean, it's these opportunities for these revelatory little bubbles that can begin to change how we understand, or that our understanding is now much larger. The event becomes much more full than what we originally thought. So that the shepherds being, you know, I'm going to take the one we talked about before. I love the image of the shepherds receiving individual revelations from the angel, not realizing that every other shepherd's getting the same revelation. But then when it happens, they're all just happy. It's not like, you know, I got a better revelation than you. Everybody's revelation is individual and special for them, but it's all equal. And then if you saw The Chosen, you know the backstory, but did you see what happened with the guy when he was running?
He got better.
He was healed as he ran.
Yes. So the author of this story is saying that just the fact that the creator became incarnate into the world began the healing process. And this isn't a miracle that Jesus did. So it's not the first miracle that Jesus did. It's a miracle of that the Father has done on behalf of the birth of the Son. It's a gift to the
world. I took the lines that were echoing in my head where, woman, your faith has made you well. So there's a woman that begs Jesus 30 years from now, and she can only reach the hem of his garment, and you see her groveling or whatever in your mind's eye, and he turns around, she's already healed, not by Jesus laying his hand on her or him actually performing a very public miracle, but by her invested faith that he has the power to do so, and he tells her that. So that's what I pictured as he was, you know, casting off his crutch and sort of starting to limp and then run. I thought it's his faith invested in this holy event that's healing as he runs.
Yes.
And is the other thing that struck me with that, is that not Simeon? Like, I expected him to drop down and start the nunc dimittis, you know. He just had that aura of the guy that has finally, his faith has finally been fulfilled. Something he's hoped for and believed in all along is staring him in the face. So is that Simeon?
No.
No, that's not something. Well, he seemed like he could say. Yes,
it's a same kind of story.
So, yeah, like yeah. You yeah. can finally be at peace. You can finally cash in because I've seen the Savior.
Yes.
Those lines.
Yep. And then the last, this is not part of the nativity story, but that last line, wasn't that last line something? The rabbi found the spotless lamb for sacrifice. And his response was perfect.
Smile.
Yes.
That sort of fear, oh no. And then the I just brilliant, you know. That's such a wonderful portrayal that can open up new ways of seeing and new ways of experiencing and new ways of receiving. Yeah, man. So we're almost out of time, but I have to give you the test. You have to have the exam, and I haven't given you all the book work yet. I want to give you just a little bit of background, a little bit of book work for you before I go halfway the time. And that is just to get us ready for the next time we meet. Okay, so part of this is, let's see, I've got this right here. I don't want that. There we go. That's getting better. Okay. Yeah, so we're talking about Matthew and Luke and John, and I left Mark out on purpose. And then you know this if you read the Creator Calling, but I just want to tell you, so gospel, the word gospel means good news. This is evangelion, which literally is the translation for good news. And there are four gospels, and three of them are like each other. They have a common view. They have a common structure. They tell a common story. And that is that commonness is held within the word synoptic. So if you ever hear someone say, is that one of the synoptic gospels? That's Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They are in common. They are alike. John is nothing like Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They are completely different. They are viewpoints. They are thematic viewpoints. There is an investment and a life process that is poured into the writing of the Gospels by the person who is writing it. The Gospels are not dictated. This is not a poor theory that was held on for a long time in the Christian church called the dictation theory of Revelation. So then what it was that, you know, Mark sat down under a tree and he was, you know, a little dozy and he was taken over by the Holy Spirit. And when he dozed off and he woke up, laying in his lap was the Gospel that he'd written, kind of like automatic writing. That the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit wrote. So that's completely wrong, right? That would be suspending Mark or Matthew or Luke's self. So the Gospels are full through and through of the ones who wrote it. And that's the way that God had planned it. So there is a life intention and a life a hope that's portrayed through the Gospel by the Gospel writer. So there's a theme that's going to be presented here based on the Gospel writer's own life and where the Gospel writer is writing or who the Gospel writer is writing to. So I want to give you a little background of these people. You have, and there's something else I want to tell you when you read, if you do the commentaries, to keep this in mind. If you read commentaries that tell you that the year of the writing of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and if that they tell you, they say Matthew was written in 70 to 85 AD. If you read that, then what that tells you is that the person who is writing that commentary, it is not ascribed to the miracles in the Gospels. Okay? Because what happened in 70? Do I have any Bible scholars that know what happened in
70? Destruction of the temple.
Yes, sir. So the Romans destroyed the temple in Jerusalem in 70 AD. And Jesus had said that the temple would be destroyed. So if they put the date of the writing of the Gospels after 70, what they're doing is they are implying that Jesus didn't say this, that the Gospeler wrote it and wrote it after 70 AD. So it's now something that happened. But they wrote it into the Gospel so it looked like Jesus was telling the future. So Now you're talking about the person who's doing the commentary. If they are saying that the gospel is written after 70 AD, now you know what you're working with. They're going to start in their commentary on the gospels, they're going to dumb down or explain away or kind of poo-poo the miracles to a certain extent because they're not on board with everything that's going on. So I'm always going to take the earlier dates. I believe the gospel for what the gospel is, an inspired word of God. So Matthew is 28 chapters long. If you read the gospel will tell you when it was written based on the description of the world around it. I can't do that tonight. It's written in about 41 AD. It's written to a Jewish community. Matthew is a Jewish person. He's writing to a Jewish community. He's telling Jewish stories. And originally they think that it may have been written in Hebrew, although we do not have any of the original texts in Hebrew. They're all in Aramaic. Very much emphasizing Christ as the king, as the heir of the throne of David, as the true branch, as the true Messiah. He quotes the Old Testament 53 times in the Gospel of Matthew. Mark was written presumably around 55, 58 AD, and I'll go into that next week because there's a lot of people who think Mark was first, which would have put him in the 40s, early 40s, and Matthew a little bit later. It's 16 chapters. He's writing to Gentile converts. And we know that because he's explaining Jewish customs. It's written in Aramaic, written in Greek. It's written in Greek, it's not written in Aramaic. So this is a Greek person. Written that Christ is very self-aware, very quick, moving rapidly, doing the stuff like this. He came to suffer, he suffers for the sins. This is a payment. This is the propitiation of sin, right? And I'm gonna stop with Luke. Luke is the physician. Right, he was very well educated. He's speaking again to Jewish converts, but he's speaking to a much broader audience. He wrote using a very sophisticated Greek in his writing. He was very careful about what he wrote, the dates and the time. His research is very, very good. He portrays Jesus and uses the term "Son of Man" over and over again, which links that back to earlier scriptures in the Old Testament. He uses that phrase 26 times, which is the fulfillment of the messianic prophecy in the Old Testament, as the complete fulfillment of the hopes and the needs and the aspirations of humankind. Okay, so all I'm going to do right now with them, just that little introduction. Well, I just do John. So I told you about John. John's written right around the same period of time, right? Completely different. He's emphasizing the deity of Jesus. It's all vignettes, it's stories about Jesus. It's not traveling here and there and here and there and here and there. It's all a little story here, a little story here, a little story here. Okay, so we're gonna cover all this next week. Just got you all excited now, but I do have the test for you. So I know that's what you really want. It's what you've been waiting for. So everybody has a chance to answer. You can blurt out the answers, that's fine. Or you can sit back and wonder what's going on. So this is really important for us for next week. Ready? So nobody needs to be muted. Here you go, ready? What gospel, and I'm only talking about Matthew and Luke now, just Matthew and Luke. What gospel in which was the family visited by the shepherds? Which gospel tells about the shepherds going to the Holy Family after Jesus is born? Matthew or Luke?
Luke.
Matthew.
Luke. It's Luke. All right. You're doing good. All right. An angel appeared to Joseph. Somebody, I think it was Jay, that said that it appeared to Joseph. Which gospel did he appear to Joseph?
Go with Matthew.
50% chance, right? Yes, he appeared to Joseph in Matthew. Okay. Wise men see the star appearing in the east. What gospel did the wise men see the star? Matthew or Luke? Luke or Matthew?
It's going to be Luke. No?
Anybody else?
To read my Bible, apparently.
It's Matthew. It was in Matthew. And I should say the one prior to that, that the angels appeared to Zechariah and the shepherds and Mary in the Luke, but they did not appear.
So is there no nativity story in Mark?
No.
There's none. Bible trivia for you. I remember learning that Mark was the speedy gospel, that everything happens immediately.
Yes, next week we're going to cover this all in real detail, so you guys will be
built. Mark is the one that it's like that little kid's one where bang, you got a baby.
Yeah. Or bang, you got an adult.
Yeah, like instant, like this. Yeah, all right, I'm not going to derail. That's good.
Angels sing the glory to God, peace on earth, and goodwill toward man. Which gospel, Matthew or Luke?
Luke.
It's got to be Luke. Which is the one we read? We read Luke, what, 2:1 through 14. The whole Christmas, we read Luke.
So Luke, wait, you got it. Will, I believe it. Luke. Will has got it that time. Luke, okay. Jesus born in a manger. Matthew or Luke? Kind of revelatory. You should be thinking about this, when I tell you it's in Luke or it's in Matthew, that means it's not in the other one. Jesus born in a manger.
The word manger has to be in Luke because of all the Christmas cards, and they and they laid him in a manger and wrapped him in swaddling cloths.
Yeah. Right.
It's like verbatim from Luke.
Okay, you're right. You discerned that one out. He's in Luke. Okay. Warned. Oh, you already got to this one. Warned. No, I didn't actually. Warned Joseph in a dream not to go, or to go and run away to Egypt.
Yeah. Mark.
Matthew or Luke?
Definitely Mark.
Matthew or Luke?
There's no nativity in Mark, he says.
Definitely Mark.
It's going to be Matthew. Matthew's the one that's all focused on the genealogy and the legality of the issue, just like the Matthew in Chosen.
Just like Mark.
And he's doing the work here. It's Matthew. Okay, Joseph and Mary, ready, are from Nazareth.
All right, so...
Matthew or Luke?
What gospel?
Matthew.
According to my logic, if Matthew is all about genealogy and family and details, then it's going to be have to be Matthew.
Right, it's Luke.
He's all hung up on that, the patriarch.
It's in Luke. Okay, Joseph's. Okay, this is wrong. Jenny. Joseph's great grandfather is Eleazar.
True. I think it's right. That's true.
He's setting us up.
I am.
I think it'll be Matthew if Matthew's what I think, but I guess
Joseph's great grandfather was Eleazar. Will is exactly right. That's true, or maybe not. And that's found in Luke. But his great grandfather is also found in Matthew, but it's Levi. So he's got two great-grandfathers. What's up with that? Well, we're going to find out next week. That'll be another one. Got two more for you. Let's see. Mary sings the Magnificat.
Oh, we got to know that one. My soul magnifies the glory of the Lord, and the Lord has shown favor. That's got to be Luke.
That's Luke. And Jesus was born in Bethlehem.
All of the above. That's also true.
You're exactly right. It is in Matthew and Luke. It's the only thing that I've said so far that's in Matthew and Luke, that Jesus was born in Bethlehem. So when we are looking at and going through the nativity story, we are really doing exactly what someone said. We are really looking at, and as you think of it right now, you are thinking of the nativity story as it is told in the two different gospels that have been put together to make a complete story.
So do we do John next week?
Yes, we're going to get into both Matthew and Luke a little deeper. We're going to find out if it's Eleazar or if it's Levi and why that would make any difference at all. And then we're going to look at John as well. Yes.
Actually, a brief commercial insert here, next week is Ellie's graduation. So we need to make a plan for the group to come together without us and then come back on the 21st.
Right. So next week it'll be something fun when we're not here. And then in 2 weeks we'll be doing everything that
But y'all still have to come on and lead Compline and pray and talk and do something together. You have to. And we are going up to George Mason because Ellie is finally graduating and she has a little party walk thing that she's going to do. And then Bill and William are coming home and I'm staying for the ceremony on Thursday. So unfortunately we have a family conflict.
Yeah. We'll get that all sorted out.
You'll put it in creator calling.
Yep.
Okay.
All right, guys. This was great. This was great. I pray everybody has a wonderful Thompson's. Just what a joy to see you guys. What a wonderful joy to see you. Absolutely. Everyone have a wonderful, 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 blessed night. Good sleep. Be safe. Be terrific. Hopefully I'll see some of you tomorrow night. And otherwise, I'll see you on Sunday.
Okay. All right. God bless everyone.
Thank you.
Good night. Bye-bye.
Good night, everybody.
Bye, honey.
Bye, Mom.